goes back to helping our community. And of course, we're seeing the priest here now enter into St. Peter Claver Catholic Church to get the Mass underway, which should start in just a few moments at this point. Again, the family was just saying their final goodbyes. They just closed the casket moments ago. And again, as you see, the priest filing in, taking part in this celebration of her life.
That's right. People have been making their way in all morning. We do know that the Mass is scheduled to start exactly at high noon. So as Randy said, the family just had their final moment to take it all in, the 96 years to take it all in, the life and legacy of Leah Chase. But the actual service is getting ready to start. We're just about a minute and a half away or so. It's scheduled to start at high noon. Seating certainly was limited inside of St. Peter Claver. So if you haven't, you know, made your way in, or if you weren't there, you likely won't be able to get inside as the service gets underway.
Yeah, but you can certainly still take part in the second line. I think that's what a lot of folks outside are doing, just kind of waiting for that second line, although it is pretty hot outside. But, you know, she's worth it. She's worth it for that second line to send her out in style. So many individuals here filing in, and so many individuals inside as this church seats about 700. So in just a few moments, we'll get our first look inside at the congregation there.
And just moments ago, you talked about how the program is going to go and the program getting underway right now. Let's take a listen in.
Thank you. My sisters and brothers, we gather in prayer as we pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, Leah died with Christ and rose with him to a new life. May she now share with him eternal glory. My brothers and sisters, we believe that all the ties of friendship and affection which knit us as one throughout our lives do not unravel with death. Confident that God always remembers the good we have done and forgives our sins, let us pray asking God to gather Leah to himself. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you willingly gave yourself up to death so that all might be saved and pass from death to life. We humbly ask you to comfort your servants in their grief, and to receive Leah into the arms of your mercy. You alone are the Holy One. You are mercy itself. By dying, you unlock the gates of life for those who believe in you. Forgive Leah her sins and grant her a place of happiness, light, and peace in the kingdom of your glory forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will provide for all people. On this mountain, he will destroy the veil that veils all people. The web that has woven all of all nations, he will destroy death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces. The reproach of his people he will remove from the whole earth. The Lord has spoken. On that day it will be said, behold, our God, to whom we look to save us. This is the Lord for whom we looked. Let us rejoice and be glad that he has saved us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Thessalonians. We do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, about those who have fallen asleep, so that you may not grieve like the rest, who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose, so too will God, through Jesus, bring with him those who have fallen asleep. Indeed, we tell you this, on the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will surely not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself, with the word of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, will come down from heaven, and then the dead in Christ will first rise. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, console one another with these words. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him. And he will separate them from one another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Ill, and you cared for me. In prison, and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him and say, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and visit you?' And the king will say to them in reply, 'Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me.'" The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord
God is good
all the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Well, since Miss Leah Chase was 96 years old, I beg you to give me 96 minutes of your time to deliver the homily this morning or this afternoon. Every minute is for 1 year. Is that okay? All right. God is good and all the time. On behalf of your St. Peter Craver Parish family, I would like to express our sincere sympathy to you, especially Mr. Leo and Uncle Dookie, and all the trouble that the kids have given to you. And not only that, to the granddaughters and the great-granddaughters, I mean the children, the extended family. We have been praying for you and with you. As you all came here on yesterday, we pray for you and with you. And we come here this morning so that God will give you the comfort and the consolation that you need at this time. We also come as a family this afternoon. And on this one, I want to say thanks to all of you who have been able to change your schedule on a Monday afternoon to be here and to pray for the poor soul of Miss Rhea Chase and also for the grieving family. Thanks to Bishop Gary, who traveled all the way from Beaumont, Texas, and all the priests who gathered here, some travel from all far and near. I cannot mention each one of them by name, but I want to say thank you for being here with us this afternoon. My sisters, embracing the Lord, for us as Christians, you know that death is not the end of our lives. And death does not have the final word. Because Jesus Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life, has already won the victory for us. Death for us is nothing but the end of our earthly life right here and the beginning of eternal life with Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
We know all that, but because we are human beings, we see God through some emotions when we encounter death, irrespective of the age of the person. I have seen and witnessed the pain, the sorrow, the grief of the Chase family. And I wish that I have the words of wisdom that I can share with you this afternoon for God to zap all those emotions away, but I don't. But I know a man that I'm going to bring you to him this afternoon.
Come on.
And this man will give you the words of comfort and consolation that you need. This man that you all know, he knows us more than you know ourselves. And he knows our heart. And I know that your heart is troubled. But he said, don't let your heart be troubled.
Yes.
But just believe in him.
That's right. That's the word.
And his word has been proclaimed to our hearing this afternoon. As you heard from the prophet Isaiah, who gave us an image of a banquet, a great banquet that God is going to prepare for us after the battle is over. It's going to be a great celebration after the victory over sin and death had been won. A celebration for all God's people, all are welcomed with the best food. And just think about the fried chicken of Dickie Chase, the crawfish etouffee, the seafood gumbo.
Well.
And you can think about the best wine you can ever drink.
Come on now.
That is the banquet that God is going to prepare for us at the end of our time.
Amen.
And then the prophet Isaiah tells us that on that day, God will destroy death. our greatest enemy forever. And there be no more sorrow. God will wipe away our tears. And when there's no sorrow, no tears, there's going to be what? Fullness of joy. And we will be in the presence of God. And we will rejoice. And we'll be glad. Because you will be our God. The God who will come to save us. But in order to be counted among those who partake in this great banquet that the prophet Isaiah tells us, you must be willing and ready to help others in small and great things, as Jesus tells us in our gospel reading. Jesus tells us that when our life here on earth is over, all of us will be judged in accordance with our reaction to the needs of our sisters and brothers. Thank God that He's not going to judge us based on our degrees. He's not going to judge us based on the fortunes we have acquired for ourselves, not about the kind of car you drive, not about your political affiliation, not about the people that you know, the hookers, you know, here in New Orleans. You got to guess, know somebody to get things done. It got nothing to do with that. It's not about the mansion that you live in. And I thank God for that. Because if it's about that, maybe I'll not be counted among those who have been invited. But very simple things that each one of us gathered here can do. That's why God is a good God. And He's going to judge us based on, say, giving 100 persons a mere meal. Anybody here can do that. Whether to somebody who is thirsty, or when you are able to welcome a stranger, or when you care for the sick, or when you visit those who are in prison. You see, Jesus is not asking us to do great and mighty things that some of us will not be able to do. You may not have the means. But it's about simple help that we give to our sisters and brothers that we encounter each and every day of our lives. This is how we are going to be judged. And Jesus tells us, whatever you do for the least of my sisters and brothers, you did it for me. We must also remember that it's like only what you do for Christ will last. And I know that Miss Chase did a lot for Christ. So she's now shared the rewards of her labors, which is eternal life, which Christ, our Lord, has prepared for her. Miss Chase had a chance to prepare herself. Not many of us will have that chance. And so my faith tells me that she is at peace with the Lord. You see, in the waters of baptism, she died with Christ and rose with Him to share His resurrection, as Paul tells us in our second reading. This is our hope. Miss Chase will rise one day with our risen Lord, and she will share His glory. So we, as people who gathered here, St. Paul tells us, we should grieve like men and women who have hope. You see, when you have no hope, you are dead. You lead to despair. But you may grieve, but grieve that one day we shall inherit the kingdom. You see, Miss Chase, only God knows how many times I anointed her. And our sacrament tells her, once you are anointed, your sins have been forgiven. So I know that she's good. And I remember our last mass, we had mass at St. Chase Chapel. You all don't know where that is. I'm going to show you. Otherwise, I'm going to tell that bishop. That was the Thursday before she made her transition to glory. And as I gave her communion, she smiled. And she received a food that will strengthen her for this journey. As I know that she has taken her her seat in God's kingdom. She prepared herself. And so we rejoice for the many good things that God has done for her. I know that she's now up there, cheering us up to continue our journey. My sisters and brothers in the Lord, on last Saturday during the vigil service at Xavier University Convocation Center, some of our community members, you know, paid their tribute to Ms. Chase, and they talk about her as a friend, as a chef, as the art advocate, and also as a civil rights advocate. She was all that, and I believe, and more. I would say Ms. Chase was a true gift to our community, to our city, our state, and our nation as a whole. But the family have given me the indulgence to talk about a woman that I know, how I know her. You see, I know her as a woman of a deep faith. All that you all said is good, but I will talk about what I know. She was a woman of a deep faith, and her faith informed and inspired her each and every day of her life. Something that most of you don't, I'm going to tell you her secret, and I hope you don't mind. She put her faith in action. What do I mean by that? She started her day with a prayer, conversation with God. And you know what she did? She asked God for the strength she needed to go through each and every day.
All right.
A woman of prayer. That's how she started her day. She knew that God was the source of her strength and the strength of her life.
Yes.
I know Ms. Chase was a woman with a grateful heart. And so she will always end her day with gratitude, not to herself, but to God, for all the blessings she was able to accomplish in the course of the day. She knew who to give the glory to. To God be the glory. You see, some of us give the glory to ourselves and feel that we got it made. She never did that. Whatever she accomplished, she gave the glory to who? To God.
Yes, yes.
And not only that, a woman of prayer, and she will say her divine mercy. Those who are not cut, don't worry about it. It's a prayer. And after the divine mercy, she will say her rosary. And she went to bed, or she went to sleep, with the rosary in her hand every night. Maybe some of you don't know the rosary, what it is. This is it. It's a very powerful weapon. It's like my credit card. I don't leave home without it. I don't leave home without it. When Satan sees it, he runs away. And that was one of her secrets. She was a demon. She was a woman of deep faith. And she had a deeper understanding of the new commandment Jesus gave us. Love one another as I have loved you.
Yes, sir.
She understood that. Her love for the family, you know what I'm going to tell you about that. Her love for her friends and the people in general. And her life, I mean, her love was very sincere and contagious. Unlike some of us, they say they love you and they stab you on your back. Ms. Chase didn't do that. When she said, I love you, she means it, I love you.
Uh-huh.
Ms. Chase had a very special way of touching people with her words of encouragement and affirmation. Every opportunity that she got, she used it as a teachable moment to empower others to be able to do good for themselves or to have a good quality life. That was the woman that I know, a woman of what? Faith. Ms. Chase was not a very self-centered person, that you all know. She was a very, very generous person and was never afraid to share her blessings with others. I remember when our first son here, I walked to the restaurant to cut a long story short. Ms. Sarah walked up to me and said, "You the new pastor?" "Yes, I am." He said, "My mama want to talk to you." And so I went to the back. And the rest is here, say, "Father, you can come here and eat anytime." I'm saying, "Are you sure?" And he gave me a free pass to the restaurant. I'm sure my pass is still activated, right? I don't want to lose that. And one thing I like about her was she was very optimistic in life. No matter how difficult the situation is or was, she would say, "God will make a way." And because she knew that God can make a way out of nowhere, she wasn't afraid of change. She believed that positive change can bring us what? New possibilities and growth. And so in one of my conversations with her in the kitchen, you know, my job, after I finish eating, I have to go and bless Miss Chase. That's how I pay for my food. At one of those conversations, he said, "Father, I know you got a tough job, but don't be afraid. Change whatever you have to change." And he said, "It's your time." He was a woman of deep faith. And he always tell the true truth. He said what was in her mind. It doesn't matter how to come out. There are some things I can't tell you yet. She was a humble and a hard-working woman who just enjoy each and every day just going to her office at the restaurant and sit at a seat. And most of the time I say, "Miss Chase, you're working too hard." And she said, "Father, we got work to do." And after that, she'll give me litany of sayings about things we got to do, about the homeless, the poor, the violence, lack of parental guidance in our city, in our state, and everywhere. She just did not just talk about that. She took time and prayed so that change may come. And she always believed that. One thing I also know about her was that she always asked God to help her to be the best that she could. And she did that. We thank God for the blessings that he has given to us through Miss Chase. God has blessed us with her for 96 years. A woman of deep faith, and I would say a true gift to our community. My sisters and brothers in the Lord, Miss Chase was a glorious woman who have left behind her name, and we who gathered here, we will recount her praises year after year. We from here we are going to lay her body to rest. But I know and I believe that her name would never leave us. Her name will continue to live on and on and on, like those virtuous women whose names are being praised in the Holy Scriptures. A time will come that when we gather like this, we will remember her deep faith and her great wisdom and her community spirit. And I give all of us a challenge before I take my seat. The 96 minutes hasn't come yet. If we really want to remember Ms. Chase very well, then all of us gathered here, we must be able to speak her language of love and live the faith that she put into action. Maybe you all didn't hear me because of my accent, right? I said, if we are going to remember Ms. Chase, all of us got to live her language of love. And we are to put our faith in action. We are to become a welcoming person just as she was. She didn't know me anywhere. But when she saw me, she just embraced me for who I am. That is what we call love. Unlike some folks, they just have to see how you talk, how you look, and what you got, and all that before they can invite you to their company. She didn't do that. And so if we are going to do anything in honor of her, now is the time for us to tear down all those barriers that separate us from one another. I lived here in New Orleans for a long time, and I know we always talk about what, 7th Ward and 9th Ward, downtown, uptown. We are so divided. Let us see ourselves as one people, one community, working for the common good. Yes. This is what Ms. Chase will want all of us to do. Since last week, I have witnessed the amount of love that we have shown to Ms. Chase. And I ask myself, if we can just love each other a little bit more, like the love we have shown to Ms. Chase, our city will be a new New Orleans. Yeah. Just let's love just a little bit more. And I pray that we may continue her legacy of prayer, her perseverance, her persistence, and her great desire to do for others. Ms. Chase, you have competed very well. You have finished the race. You have kept the faith. From now on, the crown of righteousness awaits you, which the Lord Jesus Christ, the just judge, is going to award to you. And as you stand in the presence of our Savior Jesus Christ that you love so much, may you hear Jesus telling you, "Well done, well done. Good and a faithful servant. Come and inherit the kingdom that I have prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Because I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me water to drink. I was naked and you clothed me. I was a stranger, you welcomed me. I was in prison, and you came to see me. Ms. Chase? And to the family, be assured of my prayerful support. I continue to pray for you and with you. And if there's anything we as a parish can do, if I as your spiritual director can do, please, you know how to reach me. One thing I know is that Ms. Chase has not changed her location. She has not taken the mansion that the Lord has prepared for her. She has moved from her old house to a new house. She has now moved the restaurant from Orleans Avenue to a new one at Heaven Boulevard. She has moved from her old family to join the saints of God. And thank God that she decided to move from her old house and to get a brand new life. Yes. And now Ms. Chase is starting a brand new life. And you're gonna get a new walk, yes. A new talk, yes. A new look, yes. A new dance.
Yes.
But you and I are sit here. And so we pray for one another that one day, when our time comes, we can also see Ms. Chase face to face. And I would say yes. She has moved from our old house to a new house. And now you got a brand new life. So Ms. Chase, may you rest in peace. Sleep on, sleeping on. And may your soul and the souls of all the 50 departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Let the church say amen.
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 Amen. I moved from my old house, and I moved from my old friends. I moved from my old way of strife. Thank God I moved out to a brand new life. I moved from my old house, and I moved from my old friends. I moved from my old way of strife. My whole old level mind. He changed my heart and gave me a new start. Thank God I moved out to a brand new life. Oh, can't you see? Don't you know? No, I got a new name. A brand new life. new name. I've got a new heart. I've got a new mind. And a new start is going my way. Because I moved out. Yes, I have. A brand new life.
My sisters and brothers, let us stand and let us present to God our prayers for our church, our world, for our sister, Leah Chase.
Please respond, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
As we reflect on the contributions of Leah Chase to her family, friends, and the community, let us be inspired by her motto, pray, work hard, and do for others. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our grandmother, Leah Chase. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your son's coming. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
In baptism, Leah Chase received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead her over the waters of death. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all of us gathered here, that we may remember at all times, but especially in times of trouble and anxiety, that we are loved by you, God, and that you will take care of us. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
May we all have the courage to see the good in all of God's people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
The family and friends of Leah Chase seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Through the intercession of Our Lady of Prompt Succor, may we be spared damage to life and property during the hurricane season. We pray the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Many have gone before us and await the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Well, may we pray for and remember all family members that have preceded Leah Chase, especially Hortensia and Charles Lange, Edgar Dickey Chase Jr., Emily Chase Heidel, Nathan Heidel, Cleo Lange Bayham, Charles Lange Jr., Eleanor Lange Farrellett, and Merrill Lange, and all other family members. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Let us pray for all those intentions that we hold near and dear to our heart. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Good and gracious God, hear the prayers of your people, those spoken, those deep within our hearts. Continue to enrich us and enliven us as our sister Leah Chase showed us and Jesus calls us to do for one another. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
Pray, my sisters and brothers, that our offering our very lives will be acceptable to our God.
And the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of
all his
holy church.
Be near, O Lord, we pray, to your servant Leah, on whose funeral day we offer you this sacrifice of conciliation, so that should any strain of sin have clung to her, or any human fault has affected her, it may, by your loving gift, be forgiven and wiped away through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In him, the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. You're indeed holy, O Lord, the fountain of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." the mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer to you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by your Holy Spirit.
Remember your servant, your chase whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who was united with your son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And may the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Thank you.
Please, we ask you to remain seated, and then till the priests who are going to give communion come to their position, and the ushers will lead you to the station that you go to receive communion. Thank you.
Come to the table of mercy. Receive of the wine and the bread. You who are hungry and thirsty, come and your soul will be fed. Come at the Lord's invitation. Receive from his nail-scarred hands. Eat of the bread of salvation and drink from the blood of the Lamb. Then say, Jesus, Lamb of God, I want to eat of the
bread,
and I want to live. Oh, say, Jesus. Lamb of God, Lamb of
God,
you who are weary, just come and find, come in your soul. Come to the table, Lord.
Table of mercy.
Receive of the wine.
Of the wine and the
bread. You who are hungry and thirsty. Oh.
You are hungry and thirsty.
Come in.
Soul.
Oh, just come at the Lord. And receive from his nails, go ahead. And eat of the bread. And a drink from the blood. Then cry out and say, Jesus, the Lamb of God. Now I want to live like the sun. Oh, Jesus, I come. Say, Lamb.
whose son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey. Mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our sister Leah Chase may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Please sit up for a moment. God is good
all the time.
God is good. On behalf of our St. Peter Cleaver Parish family and also the Chase family, I'd like to express our gratitude to Bishop Sherry for taking and also Bishop Gregory. Actually, the bishops are having their bishops' conference, but they changed their schedule to be here. The Archbishop could have been here too, but I saw him on Saturday, and so you gave your regards already. So thank you very much for being here this morning to be with us at this afternoon. Thank you, our brother priest, for coming to support the Chase family. And I see our mayor, thank you very much for being here. And all our elected officials who are here, thank you for the love that you have shown to the Chase family. Also, I saw some of ministers here, all the ministers who also came. We just want to say thank you. And of course, it takes a lot of people to put a program like this together. On behalf of our life, say thanks to Bright Moments, Bill, and your crew. You did an awesome job. You know, I'm not thinking right now, so I'm just going to make a general thank you. Thanks to all of you for being here this afternoon to support the Chase family. Thanks to our music ministry. What an awesome job that you have done this afternoon. And our praise team, they always do an outstanding job. Those who act as the MCs, our altar service, our Minister of Hospitality, Rose Funeral Home, thank you for the job you do. And thanks to all of you for being here this afternoon. If I forget anybody, please forgive me.
Father Sari said everything I was going to say. But that's okay. It makes my job easier. No, in a special way, I do want to say, in the name of Archbishop Amen and Archbishop Hughes, who are at the Bishop's Meeting in Baltimore, we extend our deepest prayers and condolences to your family. We ask God to especially renew you and strengthen you through the great love and support that your mom showed us and what challenges us to live on in our lives today. So we thank God for the gift she has been to us. In a special way, I'd like to also acknowledge three special people. You know, Leah had a chain of priests around. But there were three special guys who were her pastors through the years. Monsignor Frank Girard, pastor at St. Anselm. Father Jonathan Hemelt, who's pastor at Our Lady of the Rosary. And of course, our pastor here at St. Peter Claver, Father Sari Denkwa. If there's one thing I really would like to say on behalf of the church, you know, we have some great matriarchs in our church. And Leah is a great matriarch because her discipleship was not only in the kitchen. Her discipleship was witnessed and seen in many ways, shapes, and forms, in many different ways that she served and assisted many of the Catholic schools, institutions, and organizations, the way she just helped out and assisted so many people throughout the city of New Orleans. You know, she was a matriarch for everybody and really lived out that gospel that calls us to take seriously which side of the church we sit on when the priest is before us, those on the right or those on the left. You know, you should be careful where you sit in the church. Because every time I read that scripture, I always turn to the right and turn to the left. And people who sit on the left say, you ought to change that around because we're really on the right and you on the... but anyway, no. Seriously, let us live out our discipleship as she lived it out, enabling all to enjoy soul food, not only at the table of fellowship, but soul food that comes in relationship with the God she loved and served all her life. May we do the same. Amen. Bishop Cherie, Stella, Dookie, and Leah, and the family of Leah, I can just I hear her whispering in my ear, and she is saying, Bishop Gilray, be short, the food is getting cold. But just a couple of comments. I have known her for over 50 years. And my first encounter with her was a lesson in fine dining. Graduated from high school, and we were brought to Duke Chase Restaurant. And being from a farm in South Louisiana, I didn't know much about a restaurant, let alone fine dining. But she went through all of the steps, you know, the spoons, the forks, etc. Now, I have to be honest, I was not a good student because the aroma from the kitchen was coming forth, and I wanted to get into the food. But, you know, as I've come to know her, Leah was an artist. And an artist is a person who sees below the surface. An artist is one that can articulate some things that are sacred, that are holy, that are important, that we cannot articulate or bring forth. She was an artist in the kitchen, and she was an artist in the sense that she promoted and loved the arts. And the way I would describe her is the difference between a snorkeler and a scuba diver. A snorkeler goes on the surface of the water. And you know, many times that's what we do in life. Some people go their whole life surfacing or snorkeling. But she was a scuba diver. She understood the heart. She understood what united people, though different perhaps in culture, language, etc. It was because she was an artist that she was able not only to speak to, but also be present to presidents and the poor. She was able to communicate with them and bring that wisdom, that love, which she got, of course, from her faith. So yes, we're obviously going to miss her. We're going to miss our physical presence. But as with any artist, they leave behind their legacy, whether in writing or in pictures or in painting or sculpture. She leaves us her legacy, which we carry in our hearts. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister Leah. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope.
One day we shall joyfully greet her again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Leah in the sure and certain faith that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with them on the last day. We give you thanks for the many blessings which you bestowed upon her in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurances of our faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister Leah forever. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
If you wanna know where I'm going, where I'm going so soon. If anybody asks you, oh, where I'm going, where I'm going so soon, oh, you can tell them that I'm going up yonder, going up yonder, I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord, oh. I can take the pain, the heartache it brings, the comfort in just knowing I'll soon be gone. As God gives me grace, I'm gonna run this old race until I see my Savior face to face. Oh, you can tell them that I'm going up yonder, going up yonder, I'm going up yonder to be with my